Chinese. All this outcry, but you have the same law here, which is even tougher. I was told that you have a law here now in Turkey, which prohibits construction of any new non-Islamic religious buildings. You can only repair the old one as cultural monuments, museum and so on, but not build new ones. You cannot build now here a Catholic church or whatever. So, you know, like everyone has his, her, their problems. All I want to say is this. There are two things you are usually criticized for, and I will not go into, of course, you are guilty, but in what way? Of course, I'm opposed to this French stigmatization of you because of the Armenian slaughter, not because I don't think Turks did some horrible things there, but I find it greatly problematic in, I think this is an abyss of political correctness, this attempt to try to legalize crimes in the sense of if you deny this crime, this, if, because you know, then you open it. Now another will say, what about our genocide and so on and so on, and then we are approaching a ridiculous era when you will have then two types of crimes, you know, like if you kill less than 500,000, you still can deny it. If you kill more than 500,000, you can deny it, and so on. This is generally the ethical problem of what in the West they call political correctness, where something that should be part of our, let's call them spontaneous customs, habits, they try to formalize it, to legalize it, and the effects are always catastrophic here. But I think your answer here should be another one, which I don't hear it often enough. Yes, why not? You should, not because of the pressure of the West. Screw them. You, for your own good, you should openly admit, yes, we did horrible things and so on. Armenian skirts. But you should point out something which would be the true answer to Europe. Remember who did this. The Young Turks, those precisely who were imitating Europe, who wanted to become a modern European nation state. So Europe ideologically is in no position to simply criticize you here. You just did what most of the emerging nation states in Europe did. This is, I'm sorry, but this is the history of modern nation state. Okay, some more violent, some less violent. But for example, read the history of early absolutist France, 17th, 18th century. How much crackdown was there already in late Middle Ages on that, how's it called, where there was the great rebellion against Cathars in the south, then Bretons and so on. All nation states are founded on more or less strong genocide or whatever. The English and so on and so on. So, okay, I agree, you did horrible things, but then what did United States do? What did others do and so on and so on? Even Israel, I don't, of course I'm pro-Palestinian, but nonetheless, we should make it clear that the problem of Israel is that they are doing now what other states were doing 300-400 years earlier. They just try to build now a nation state. So again, your answer should be, yeah, should be that this precisely was the gift of Europe to you. The genocides you did, no? And in this sense, when I say Ottoman, my God, I'm not an idiot. I'm well aware what kind of a lethargic, passive, conservative regime the Ottoman Empire was. All I'm saying is this. If there is a lesson of the 20th century, it is the horrors of nation state. And this is why, retroactively, this is the only thing that interests me about Ottoman Empire. Even Soviet Union tried to be this, but failed. I think it's crucial for us to invent new political model of some kind of a unity, be it state or whatever, which is no longer based on ethnic belonging as a fundamental criterion. This is why I think not in the sense of returning to Ottoman Empire. Then another reproach I was told, sorry, connected to this, that I celebrate too much Islamic tolerance and so on. My God, I'm well aware of the horror of Islamic fundamentalism. But you know what's my position here? All great, I'm a total atheist, but all great religious texts are written in an opportunistically ambiguous way. You know, they offer possibility for this or for that. Take Christianity. God says, Christ, you know, if somebody strikes you on the right cheek, turn the left one, love your enemies, whatever. But then I can imagine God dictating this, and then God said, wait a minute, there may be situations where you need a little bit of violence, so Christ said, okay, let's add, I bring sword, not love, you know. Like God, all gods were opportunists, you know. They said A, but to make it sure, they added the opposite, like love, don't kill, except when you really have to kill them. So the same goes for Islam. If we criticize today's Islamic fundamentalism, we should always be aware that, let me tell you just two, three things that you should know, and I'm in no way pro-Islam. This is a nice tragic story. Do you know that when Crusaders occupied, liberated Jerusalem, they didn't kill many Arabs there. They mostly used them as servants. But they certainly killed all the Jews there, no? Mm. And do you know that then when Saladin reoccupied Jerusalem, do you know that one of the first public proclamations of Saladin was a public appeal to the Jews, now it's safe to you, you can come back. Or another detail from ex-Yugoslavia, my own, when we had the terrible war, civil war in early 90s. We learned, you know, it was the only part of ex-Yugoslavia where there was a really considerable Jewish population. Sarajevo. Why? Because it was Muslim dominated. It's crazy if you compare it with recent Middle East problem. They were, for historical reasons, the only ones who tolerated Jews there. We, others, we in Slovenia, Croatia, Serbia, we threw them out already in the 16th, 17th century and so on. This also, I'm so sad I don't have time to develop this, but this also allows you to explain, nonetheless, if I approach a little bit Middle East topic, another strange click which I found really worrying. You remember that madman, but he's not a madman, Breivik, who killed the people in Oslo. You know why not? Because I claim that all the right-wingers relaxed when psychiatrists proclaimed him a clinical madman. Because this means it's just madness, it's not serious. But if you look a little bit, I did, at his manifesto, hundreds of pages of reflection, no, this is not madness. This is a very consistent explanation of a certain vision of a crisis of Europe. And what is so important there is that, and this is really Breivik as an omen of where we are. He is anti-Semitic in the West. He says, for example, Norway and Europe, Western Europe, we are lucky because we don't have too many Jews. But he says England and especially United States, they have too many Jews, they will have to deal with this problem, blah, blah. But at the same time, he's totally pro-Zionist. We have this paradox, literally, of an anti-Semitic pro-Zionist. Anti-Semitic towards Jews in Western societies, but totally pro-Israel in the Middle East. Yes, because their state of Israel is the protection against Islam and so on and so on. And this, I think, is something very dark. First, a similar thing is happening in the United States. The conservative Baptist, the Christian right, They are in a discreet way, sometimes not even